Thank you, Brian. It's nice that you saved the best for last. We always appreciate that. Knowing who the group was, I said, Dale, you got to really come and help me with this. You really got to do this because Dale is a bird biologist. He is a wonderful expert. He's been the person responsible for the restoration of swans in western Montana, really, and on the reservation. So his expertise is excellent. So just a little bit, usually in a background for a person from the tribes, you give a little background to yourself. I am a member of the tribes. My family resided not too far from here. We have a ranch by Fort Kana. And Angus McDonald came to, my great-great-grandfather came to Montana through Hudson Bay fur trading in, I guess in western Montana, about 1840. And he, of course, his wife was a Nez Perce woman who was half Nez Perce, half French, and half Iroquois. And so that started one side of my family tree here on the reservation. Dale didn't put this slide up intentionally, but that mountain right there is named after Angus, McDonald Peak, and then right below it is McDonald Lake. And it's a fabulous shot. One of the reasons why I love working for the tribes is that they have such an innate respect for the land and the fish and wildlife resources. Knowing how to live in balance with everything and having that deep connection. But those mountains right there signify the first private and tribal wilderness in the United States, the Mission Mountain Tribal Wilderness Area. It's about 93,000 acres. And it was established in 1988 as the first one in the United States, which is really pretty proud. I am a recovering fisheries biologist and wilderness manager. So another reason why Dale needed to come along, because otherwise we'd be talking about fish all the time. So I have a bunch of handouts out here, and when I talk about history, you know, that kind of stuff, the history that I'm familiar with is the history that basically we've been producing and working upon for the past 40 years. And some of the documents we have out here, we have some educational DVDs that are wonderful resource material that have the interviews with our tribal elders. They're bilingual, but they really go into a lot of the detail of how our people lived 100 years ago, 200 years ago, 500 years ago, 10,000 years ago. Really great information in those DVDs. One is about the Jocko River. And it's the restoration and the life cycle of bull trout. When we look at managing resources, it's really, you see lots of information about bald eagles, grizzly bears, you know, fangs and fur, a lot of great things. But where do you see that information about bull trout, life cycle bull trout? Why are they important? What are their needs? Why are they so critical to us in sustaining ourselves on this planet in the future or here in western Montana? So that DVD, Exploring the River, that's out there, talks about bull trout. Puts that sense of place, the importance for like the Salish and Kootenai people. One of the things of bull trout, one of the promises that the Pawnee and Salish people did for bull trout was they sustained themselves off of bison. A lot. The Pawnee Indians were huge into bison hunting. Back in the day before horses, they had permanent encampments over here in this side of the mountains. And in fact, it is in the present day Helena. As horses came, then things changed. Migration patterns changed a little bit. And then as other tribes advanced from the east to the west and started crunching some of the indigenous people here more into the mountains, things changed even further. But when bison were in short supply for the Pawnee people, the one food that was always there for them was bull trout. Bull trout could always be relied upon as a food that was always available. So when they started running short, they could catch these. With some of the early railroad surveyors in Flathead Lake in that area, they described as these big salmon Well, there was no salmon in Flathead Lake. They were huge bull trout or Dolly Varden in large numbers, and the Indians had an easy time catching those. So when food support got low, they would go out and catch bull trout. They made the promise then that, of course, you've sustained us. You've kept us alive. We will always promise to make sure you're here. We will give back to you. So that's part of that Living in Balance DVD. It talks about some of that stuff and interviews with elders and why it's so important. That that's part of the fabric of why there are still Pend'oreille, Salish, and Kootenai people on the landscape is because of that food source. So the same respect and due respect goes to bison. So they went over to the mountains, and that's part of the history I always like to talk about because we're into contemporary management of bison, Yellowstone bison, bison on the National Bison Range, and the Salish and Kootenai people are always kind of in the headlines with some of that. But the Pend'oreille people really had a connection with, not to say that the Kootenais didn't or the Bitterroot Salish didn't, but I remember my dad, he was going through early Fort Conner records. And in 1852, he talked about the journal, and it was Angus McDonald was writing in that journal. And he said, oh man, these guys are just, they have an insatiable appetite for bison. And they traded that summer, or that fall when they came back, with just Fort Conner in the heart of the Mission Valley, right here. They traded over 5,500 bison hides with him at that fort. And so when they would go over bison hunting, you know, they would go over 500 people, and they would rally up with a lot of, there was another really interesting article in one of the early papers out of Polson, I can't remember if they called it the Flathead Courier, or anyway, it was the Polson paper. And the author had done an interview with this Aeneas lady. And so she was a young child in the late 1800s, mid-1800s, actually. And she talked about, he said, what were your favorite memories? Her family ran the ferry where Polson Bridge is today on the Flathead River. And so they ran this ferry that would ferry people across the river. And she said, wow, one of my most spectacular memories is watching all the Indians come over from the west, the Colvilles and the Spokanes, and they would ride over, and for 3 days, it was solid, 3 days of people coming to meet up with the Pend'oreilles to go over and hunt bison. Of course, they did that in large groups because at that point in time, the Blackfeet had moved down, and there was a lot of warfare between the Blackfeet and all the Salish and Kootenai, Salish-speaking people. So it was a matter of safety. The other DVD that's really worth noting on the history of the tribes is Fire on the Land that's out there. And so a lot of times people think people didn't affect the environment here. Well, the environment of the entire continent was affected by indigenous people prior to European settlement. So there's a lot of fires, a lot of different things. And so this is specifically talking about fire out here. A fire was used as a tool to manage the habitat, to affect change and opportunity for subsistence hunting and fishing, gathering. And then the last one, which is out there for your use, is the Lower Flathead River. And so this is a production that we put together based on an event that we started doing almost 20 years ago. And it's an educational event to teach local youth how to live in balance with the river, how to respect the environment, how to do appropriate things, you know, like not off-road and tear up things, or, you know, appropriate fishing limits, and just a collage of things that would take care of the riparian area and use. And we host an educational 3-day event for all the local schools on the reservation, and for that fact, Western Montana. We have to turn down schools. But we service about 1,200 youth in a 3-day, used to be 3 days, we shrunk it down to 2 days because now we do a lake honoring also on Flathead Lake. And we dedicated 1 day of our staff time and all the people that collaborate on it to talk about Flathead Lake and the issues of Flathead Lake, from water quality to invasive species to other things. So This is an offshoot of that educational program, so it talks about the vegetation, the plants and animals along the river. It's really a cool one. We do have an app that you can download that does the same thing. It's even expanded. That's really cool. So I encourage you to grab any of the stuff out there on the table that we have. The other thing, of course, is my duty to talk about the colleagues, the great colleagues like Dale Becker that I work with. Out here we have a pamphlet about our Division of Fish and Wildlife. So the tribes have a unique government in a lot of Indian country. Our tribes, when, you know, at the turn of the century, there was a lot of tough things happening in Indian reservations around the country and the Depression and things like that. And there was an individual that was commissioned to do a report on the status of Indians in the United States. It's called the Collier Report. Based upon that report, they drafted the Indian Reorganization Act in the 1930s. And it set forward a recommendation for tribes to reconfigure themselves with a tribal constitution and basically go from a chief form of government or whatever it was to an elected official and a tribal council and a constitution. The Confederated Salish-Kootenai Tribes, or the Salish-Kootenai tribes, at that time were the first tribe to adopt a constitution under the Indian Reorganization Act. Since that time, it's provided a steady and stability to tribal government. Not that it didn't exist before, it did. The reservation was a very wonderful place once that was created in 1855 for the people of our tribes. But when they did the Indian Reorganization Act, there had already been a lot of changes on this landscape where the reservation was open to homesteading and surplus lands were gone. There was a lot more demand for the local resources. Tribes couldn't practice their subsistence hunting and fishing activities that they had done previously because of all the other conflicts on the landscape. So the tribal council, that form of government, provided a new stability. And our tribe has been fortunate, more than other tribes in Montana, to have elected officials that remain, that get reelected. And they have five elected officials that have to be renewed every 2 years. They're four-year terms. And that has the continuity and that knowledge base that's gathered from having long-term elected officials, at least with the tribal community, has been very beneficial for the Salish-Kootenai tribes. That stability has allowed them to develop programs, management philosophies, and to be able to take over when the opportunity arises, like the Indian Self-Governance Act, to take over federal programs and manage those. And that really is the beginning of Dale's wildlife program, or our fisheries program, where we're able to take over federal functions from the BIA, and the tribal council were able to provide their own direction on how they manage resources. Not some bureaucrat from Washington, D.C., the Bureau of Indian Affairs, or someone that's not connected to the tribes, but from the tribal council themselves. So that was really beneficial. That leads to our division. The Natural Resource Department within the tribes was created in 1980. And from that point forward, there's been an expansion of management by the tribes from managing their own forests to managing fisheries, managing hydropower, and all those types of things. So it's been very beneficial. So right now, in the Natural Resource Department, we have the Division of Fish, Wildlife, and Recreation. We have a fisheries program, the wildlife program Dale's going to talk about, a wildland recreation program that manages the wilderness area and outdoor recreation sites. We have an information and education program, which produces many of the things out on the table that you have. I feel very fortunate. I've been accused, I think I mentioned this to some of the folks already tonight, that it's really a United Nations Agenda 21 item, some of the things we produce. Then, of course, we have our conservation program, which is our game wardens. And there's been, through the history of us managing, there's been a conflict between us, and not the federal government, but the state government. So when you look at this landscape, you know, it's the reservation. You know, there's only so much land, we can't create more land. This is our land base. This is the land that we signed a treaty for, ceded ownership of 22 million acres to reserve this 1.2 million acre homeland, but retained the right to hunt and fish on all those 22 million acres outside of the reservation. That's the Hell's Gate Treaty. But when resource management for fisheries or wildlife occurs on this reservation, the state of Montana was managing also. So we ended up with a conflict with the state. The fact is, who is managing the fishery? And who is licensing? And it really came down to an argument over licensing, where people were buying dual licenses to go fishing or dual licensing to go bird hunting. And then we ended up with a lawsuit. We sued the state of Montana. This was 26 years ago. 26 years ago. Federal court action, basically the federal judge said to both the tribes and the state, you know what? Neither one of you are going to like the way I'm going to rule. So it's my recommendation, and this is always a good thing to do. You guys sit down, talk it out, come to a mutual agreement. Rather than spend years and years litigating, see if you can't come together and come to a reasonable solution. Well, that was done. We ended up what we called the Bird Hunting and Fishing Cooperative Agreement between the state of Montana and the Confederated Salish-Kootenai Tribes. That's been in play now for going on 27 years. It's worked really well. We've created a Reservation Fish and Wildlife Advisory Board, which has equal membership of non-members and tribal members. We have a neutral board member that's has to be a federal employee that both the state and the tribes concur upon, so there's a tiebreaker in case of that ever happens. We've never had that. It's always been everything we've gone to the board has been unanimous, been wonderful. And those actions that involve rulemaking for non-tribal members on the reservation and regarding to bird hunting and fishing, because that's what the cooperative agreement covers, there's no big game hunting on the reservation by non-members. It's just bird hunting and fishing. And not upland bird, but waterfowl and pheasants and huns. So for anything for a non-member, those rulemaking then have to be concurred upon by the State Fish and Game Commission. It's part of that, and then also by the Tribal Council. So that's a secondary endorsement or approval level that goes by every year. And that's kind of the way we are with that. Our program, so some of the unique things that we do is for our fisheries program, I mentioned our tribal wilderness, which is unique and a very wonderful resource. But the tribes have given management for resources for native flora and fauna. So when we talk about fisheries management, as I mentioned about bull trout, we're going to give preference to native fish species. And so our resource management is geared towards that, the protection, restoration, enhancement of native fisheries. The One River, the bull trout DVD out there, Explore the River, is about our restoration of the Jocko River. We were able to take funding that we acquired from the mining activity in Butte and the damage to our Aboriginal fishing rights on the Clark Fork, and use that money to restore critical bull trout habitat in the river channel itself on the Jocko. So we were able to take a river that was severely degraded but still had the potential to be a wonderful trout river or bull trout river and bring it back into a natural morphology. So get it back on the floodplain. Great project, covers all that. So it's a really cool thing. The other thing that our fisheries program is involved in that you may hear all the time is bull trout. Excuse me, the reason why they were listed as a threatened endangered species, the listing came from the Flathead Lake population of bull trout. So bull trout Some bull trout live in a stream or a river, and they may spend their whole life cycle there. But Flathead Lake, being such a large lake, the largest surface area lake in the western United States, the bull trout that have evolved there have migrate up into the upper Flathead River system, spawn and come back. It's like an ocean-going salmon population. There's still smaller populations of bull trout that live up in those streams, resident, that stay up there year-round. But that bull trout population in Flathead Lake severely declined. It crashed because State Fish, Wildlife, and Parks didn't know one of their management actions was going to have an effect on the bull trout in the way that it did. They were looking at increase in productivity for kokanee fishery, rainbow fishery, in lakes around western Montana. And there was an example up in Canada where they introduced what they call Mysha shrimp as a food source. Increases the growth rate of these fish. Well, they did that in some of the lakes that feed into the Flathead Lake. And the Mysha shrimp came down into the lake. And when it did, the Mysha shrimp caused the kokanee population to collapse. They affected the food web. They ate the zooplankton that kokanee liked. Their population just blossomed, the Mysha shrimp. And when the kokanee population started crashing, at the same time, the non-native lake trout population was eating the Mysha shrimp. And in Flathead Lake, prior to that time, lake trout, of course, were introduced at the turn of the century, along with Lake Superior whitefish and kokanee about the same time. The lake trout, previous to that, only about 1 in 100 would make it to adulthood as a fry. And when the Mysha shrimp showed up, it was like Gerber food for them. And all of a sudden, 99 out of 100 were making it to adulthood. So the biggest predator in that food chain in the natural system used to be bull trout. And all of a sudden, all these lake trout show up and start eating everything. They start eating the baby bull trout. They start eating. They're eating themselves out of house and home. Really, it's amazing. So we all looked at that. There was some litigation accordingly, and bull trout were listed. So our management then became a recovery plan in Flathead Lake for that population. So what we do in our fisheries program is we are trying to reduce the lake trout population to give bull trout a chance. They're slower to adapt. They are showing some signs of recovery. They're starting to build up a little bit. If the climate change or other things don't become a factor for them, we believe we're on the right course right now. So what we do is we promote what we call MAC days. So one of the things, when you manage fish and wildlife resources, you try to use the people, the anglers, the hunters, manage your populations for you. And so what a better tool than angling. Can we increase angling pressure on lake trout to benefit bull trout? That was our experiment. That was both us and the state of Montana's solution to try to figure out what to do. If it didn't work, we were going to add some agency netting to help reduce. We're actually in that stage where we're doing a combination of both. But right now, we do a thing called fall and spring MAC days. Spring MAC days is on right now. We encourage folks with clean boats, very clean boats, boats that have never touched mysis or quagga or zebra mussel water, to come in and help us reduce lake trout in Flathead Lake. So right now is our first weekend of lake trout fishing on Flathead Lake for spring MAC days. Then we have about a, 100 fishermen, that anglers that are really good at catching lake trout. I'm a fisheries person. I have a bass tracking boat. I'm a fly fisher. I think I was born with a fishing pole in my hand sometimes. But when it comes to catching lake trout in a big lake and deep water fishing, I'm really bad at it. These guys go out right now and they catch 100 fish in 3 hours with the two-pole limit. They literally have two fish on almost all moments. So the first day, this last Friday, one guy limited it out by 11 in the morning. And then there was 10 others that limited out. So that's That's amazing. They caught over 6,000 fish, 100 guys and gals. But it's troubling also because our goal is to fish them down, you know, and when they start, you know, those kind of records come up. Either we're really getting good at catching them or, you know, there's a little rebound. But typically what happens, and out there we do have a Flathead Lake map for you. And in that Flathead Lake map, it shows the hot spots where you can catch lake trout. It's color-coded. We also have a MacDay's website, and it can teach you how to catch a lake trout. We went out with the best of them years ago, the best anglers, and said, how you catch them? You know, so there's jigging techniques, there's trolling techniques, there's shoreline techniques. So help us out there if you can. And I'm going to stop because I'm losing my voice, and I'd really like to have questions later on. I'm going to turn it over to Dale Becker and his PowerPoint.
Yeah, you can't. I find more often you can't teach an old guy new tricks. So, Tom mentioned, I've been working for the tribes for probably 28 years in my capacity as program manager. Come June, and I was there 4 years before that doing a research project for the BIA. I grew up an Iowa farm kid. And 2-3 years ago when I went back to my 40th class reunion, some of my classmates kept asking me, well, you think you'll move back here to retire? And I don't know if you've spent much time in Iowa, but basically from the west side of the state where I live to the east side of the state is solid corn. And so when people ask me that, I think about this place and no, I won't be back again. but they like it and they want to stay there, so that's good. Having technical problems. We can just finger along here. Okay. Tom talked a little bit about reservation history, the more recent stuff. If you look at 1855, when the Treaty of the Hell Gate was signed between the United States and the Confederated, well, at that time, the Salish, the Kootenai, and the Upper Pondere tribes, the land ownership on our maps today is green for tribal lands, and so that's about what it looked like. Along about 1909, the reservation was opened to homesteading. Just before that, the Allotment Act was created to provide homesteads and allotted lands to tribal members for farming and making a living off of. After 1910, when the reservation opened up to homestead, the map got a little bit more complicated. The light stuff is fee land, private land. The allotments are still there in brown, and tribal land ownership has shrunk quite a lot. National Bison Range and some irrigation properties were created to spur the irrigation project that exists there now. And then we move up to today, and it's still a fairly complicated landscape. A lot of the allotments have disappeared, been sold off either to the tribes, other tribal members or non-members. And so this is where we are today. And it's, like I say, it's a complicated landscape, a lot of ownerships, state, federal, private, tribal. So this is the environment that Tom and I work in. It's about 1.34 million acres. Multiple landowners, diversity of habitats, incredible diversity of habitats, abundant resources, clash of cultures, as you might expect, jurisdictional issues, as Tom talked about a bit ago with the hunting and fishing agreement. Tribal population is a minority population within the reservation boundaries, creates its own set of foibles, different values amongst non-Indians and Indians, a lot of landowners issue, or land issues, land management issues. And that's where we find ourselves in my job doing fish and wildlife. One of the more recent hot topics is water rights, which you probably have seen a little bit in the paper or heard on the news. And so fascinating environment to work in. One of the cool things, though, if you're a wildlife guy, is there's a lot of conservation lands. The purple area, of course, in the middle is the bison range, a couple of wildlife refuges, Nine Pipe and Pablo. Nine Pipe there, Pablo up here. They're tribal lands with under long-term easement, the Fish and Wildlife Service for refuge management. A couple of bighorn sheep management areas here and here. This is an elk management area. This is an older elk management area. Tribal wilderness area Tom talked about, a buffer zone to try to buffer neighboring activities upon the buffer or on the wilderness area. This is a 10,000 acre grizzly bear management zone with some summer closures to provide good feeding habitat for grizzly bears. And these green lands are mitigation lands that were purchased with funds from a settlement from the then Kerr Dam, the now SKC or SKQ Dam, and then some of the fisheries acquisitions with the Arco settlement are down here, these brown shaded areas. And then there are two tribal primitive areas that are for entry only for tribal members. And so a lot of conservation stuff going on here. This is my staff. I take a tremendous amount of pride in them. Some of us old bearded characters toward the back there have been there a little longer and they're getting a little long in the tooth. Some of the younger folks were trainees or are trainees in our program. We basically build biologists with a program we have for tribal member students. And so I have the privilege of working with these great folks each day. Our wildlife program actually came into existence. It was contracted from the Bureau of Indian Affairs, a small program they had back in 1988. And basically there are two components, just overall general wildlife management and then mitigation activities related to the settlement for the Kerr Dam, or that should be SKQ, made some changes pretty quick yesterday. This is kind of an overview of our staff. Our program mission, like everybody's program mission, is fairly lofty, but we tried to keep it down to earth and rational. And we aim for providing and maintaining viable species of all the terrestrial wildlife species. And we'll talk about some of our activities along those lines. I use this slide that I lifted from British Columbia's Ministry of Environment at a conference several years ago. And it says it all. I use it in about every presentation I do. It's, you know, we hear about ecosystems and the importance of all the parts. Aldo Leopold talked about that. And wise tinkering, you don't throw the parts away. And so wherever we look at animals that we have some special concerns about or we're working on. They fit in here somewhere. I'll talk a little bit about trumpeter swan restoration a little later, and there they are right there. We're also doing northern leopard frogs, these guys down here. And you pull a piece out of that, and you've got a missing part. And that's the way we looked at it as contemporary wildlife biologists, and as we settled into our jobs and started talking with tribal elders, that's the way they looked at it too. And so what could potentially be a clash of cultures in wildlife hasn't really worked out that way. We have an outstanding working relationship with both the culture committees and the elders provide amazing information to us on some of the questions we have. So our activities, I won't go read all of these, but this kind of gives you an idea. I had the unique chance, rather than going to work for the Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, which, you know, is a good outfit, certainly. Back in 1989, I chose to stay here and take this program, the helm of this program, when it was contracted. Because in my business, you don't get an opportunity to build a program anymore very often, and this provided it. And so with my staff and direction from the council and a lot of discussion, looking at the issues on the ground, this is kind of the program we built. And we aim to be a full function program that deals with habitat and wildlife, both, and also the whole gamut of species, and 309 that we have as resident or migrant coming through. One of the big things we faced early on is just getting a handle on what we have. And so, like I mentioned, you know, we certainly needed to deal with grizzly bears, a very important cultural species, also a listed threatened species. Big game population, very important for subsistence hunting. But all those other things that sometimes people don't see very often, like non-game birds, bats, amphibians, reptiles. We wanted to get a handle on what we had there for those. I mentioned, you know, game management is important. Species up the top are largely food items. Those in the bottom are more sought after by sport hunters, but also food items for them. And so we're interested in all of those. Shifting into some individual species things, to mention, we spend a fair amount of time on grizzly bears. We do surveys in the missions, which aren't easy foot patrols, so we spend a fair amount of helicopter time. Some of the new techniques that are out there, hair snagging with either baited sights or scent sights to see who you've got out there for bears. The more newer technologies using infrared motion sensitive cameras, and technology in both those just leaps and bounds every day. And so we're getting a lot better handle on our bears. This kind of reminds you when you go in the hospital, you get the same treatment, except you may not have a snare around your back leg, just in case. But we collect quite a bit of data so that we know our population as well as we can. grizzly bears, even though they're wilderness species, or that's the way we think of them, as they have had protection and they've been able to range out a little bit, our bears, kind of like the ones in the Rocky Mountain front, spend a lot of time in lower elevations. And these are about six bears that spend time in the valley in the summer, mostly family groups, females with cubs of the year or yearlings. This is the town of Ronan here. St. Ignatius is a bit off the map here, but this is Nine Pipe Reservoir, if you're familiar with the area. Charlotte's over here. And so with some of the GPS collars that are out now, you got just amazing ability to collect a lot of information. You can almost pull them up and watch the bears move. We watched one at Kicking Horse Reservoir a couple years ago. 1 half hour, she was over here. Next half hour, she was somewhere in here with her cubs swimming, and then next half hour, she was over here back in the woods again. And so it really provides you a lot of information on where they go, what they do, what they're doing, when they're at any given spot. If you got a problem bear that we have a collar on, we can get a pretty good handle on where she's hanging out, you know, like this one here, I believe there's a commercial chicken farm right up here. And I don't think had any problems there. She was just there with cubs. A few years ago, everybody decided that it was time to start raising chickens in western Montana. And that first spring, my guys spent about all their time from April to November just dealing with chicken issues. We've kind of gotten out in front of it now, but every spring this time of year, it's just reiterating that, yeah, you got to hook that electric fence up, you got to do these things, do that, and you shouldn't have any problems. And, you know, people that do, by and large, aren't. We try to monitor females with cubs, try to put transmitters on them because they're really the barometer of what the population is doing. If they're doing well, the population is doing well. We've had some different issues. This is really a hot spot for grizzly bears. This used to be a dairy farm that we bought, and no buildings are there now. It was a real problem sanitation-wise for bears. And the guy was busted back in 1984 for killing a female and probably a younger bear. And we became his probation officer. We fenced a lot, the whole dairy operation, and really didn't have any more problems. The guy here had a few problems, but basically we did a lot of electric fencing there, and things worked out well. He subsequently decided to start raising corn, and so we're working now in the cornfield here and the one here to try to just figure out what works the best for electric fences that will still let a center pivot roll across over a braided electric mat and let bears come and go, because he doesn't mind him in his corn. He gets a kick out of him. And at the same time, you know, he still is able to put a crop in, get it out. So we've done some work with conservation easements. We're doing some riparian restoration up here. We did a aspen seep burn project and restoration there. Had a subdivision proposed here, and we were able to put a funding package together and bought that piece so it wasn't subdivided, creating, you know, additional problems, potential conflicts. And I mentioned conflict management. We've converted or got most of the bee owners to electric fence, and they like it. It works. It's just very potent as long as it's maintained. Garbage still a problem. Small stock like pigs, goats, sheep, chickens, again, are difficult. We move bears. We have wolves. We investigate those and work with the property owner to get them reimbursed through the mitigation program with the Department of Agriculture, Department of Livestock, I mean. And we try to the best we can to work with landowners to help them if they've got depredation with big game. We do a lot of environmental reviews on projects. Tribes have an active timber sale program, and so we work quite a lot with forestry and trying to buffer the impacts of timber harvest and do some things that are beneficial for habitat. It's cow country, just like most of Montana, and so we have a lot of range leases. We try to get the best shake for wildlife on those. Always something being constructed, and so look at, you know, how we can do some things, build things into those projects and lessen impacts. The biggest thing that's changing the Mission Valley, east side of the reservation, It's just subdivision. Poor subdivision laws, although Polson or Lake County's density mapping process has really done some good, especially in some of the more important wildlife areas. But it's just a popular place to live, great place to live, good schools and everything. And so there's a lot of subdivision pressures, which a lot of those take ranch and farmlands out of production and subdivide them. And so we lose wildlife habitat in the process. Getting a second part of the wildlife program is the dam and the mitigation. The package we developed, there's two pieces, one habitat acquisition, restoration, and the other one just an implementation strategy, which deals with monitoring different populations and a lot of other things that we do on the ground. The primary facets of the thing were to acquire the habitats, restore those, and look at off-site habitats that we could do some good on, restore native species, and then just inventory monitoring both wildlife and habitats. So these are kind of acreages we've been working on. The agreement entailed acquisition of about 15,000 acres all told. 1,800 of that is Flathead Lake Varial Zone, basically the ring around the bathtub when the lake goes down. Another almost 1,000 is that same type of habitat in the lower Flathead River, and then about 312 acres of higher elevation riparian habitat that basically has been changed a lot because the dam operation cuts the top of the hydrograph off, and so you don't get those periodic flushing flows that make a lot of deciduous shrubs and trees, especially cottonwood, gives them good germination sites. So the river riparian has tended to go toward juniper and ponderosa pine instead, which is a diverse habitat. So I have another number of different enhancement projects that kind of go the gamut. Weeds are huge. Everybody's got weeds. If you kick a rope over a rock, you have a new weed infestation. So that's a big thing, and then just working in a number of different ways to restore habitats and try to beef up the quality of habitats that we're working with on those sites. And one of the things, I always call this the if you build it, they'll come slide. These are drained wetland areas, kind of in the Charlotte area, out in the Mission Valley. You can see where the potholes were. But were ditched and drained. And they were sites that we acquired, basically put the water back into the system, and you got that. Got this now. So you have wetland restoration, but at the same time, you we're working on cleaning grassland up and getting some good cover, primarily nesting habitat for birds and a number of other species. One of the things we try to do, these are all irrigable lands, and so we pay our O&M costs for our share of the water, too. I don't think we use all of the water that we're allotted, because a lot of these basically are on channels. They're either on the irrigation project canals like this, or they're in natural channels and return flows from neighboring properties that run downhill end up in our area, and so we try to capture that water and reuse it a second time and beef up wetland habitat for waterfowl. This is a large area just west of Dixon, Montana. It's historically Old Oxbow, the Flathead River. You know, pretty much read that right there. And railroad came in the 1880s, kind of diked it and cut it off there. And here again, this is one of those areas that one little piece down here was on the project, the irrigation project, is an irrigable field. A lot of this bench land up above is irrigated. And again, return flow water heads for the Flathead River. We catch it in these wetlands, And while it's there, a lot of the sediment drops out. The wetlands tend to clean the water a little bit, and it moves on, and then eventually some of it goes to the river. In our swan restoration project, we built this one, and within 2 years, we had a pair nesting here that pretty much nests right in here every year, and more recently, one that's moved in down in this area. And so, again, it's kind of if you build it, they'll come. Part of the upland work I mentioned a little bit ago deals with just getting native plants out. We've got a couple of tracks that are dominated by native plants, but if you look closely here, you got a fair amount of knapweed there. And so we're doing things with insects, some mechanical treatments, and some other things to try to knock some of those noxious weeds back, and then seed with native plant species to try to give them a little more of a competitive edge to outdo the knapweed and some of the other noxious ones. And we're also on one of these sites that's never been plowed. We work with the culture committee to try to restore camas and try to enhance some of the other medicinal plants that the elders and traditional practitioners use for medicines. And then there are just a number of different wildlife monitoring projects that, small mammals, amphibians, birds, that we do either annually or periodically to see how our progress is on the habitats. Same thing with monitoring wetlands and grasslands. How are we doing? Circle around to visit that and replan and adjust as we need to. With the part of restoration of native species, in the 90s, first one we worked on is peregrine falcons. We now have about 5 peregrine pairs that nest on the reservation that we know of each year. We been working on trumpeter swans since the mid-90s, and swans have moved from the reservation on northward, and we have birds clear up at Eureka now, and filling in a lot of vacant habitats in the upper Flathead. We did a population viability study recently, and what it told us that we've got a very strong chance to maintain a viable population in the short term, 25 years, and the long term, 100 years. So that's good news. Northern leopard frogs down here used to be very abundant. The tribal elders told us about how abundant they were when they were kids. They were up until about the 70s, and then pretty much just blinked really fast. And so we've worked with Fort Belknap and also the Blackfeet tribe to bring egg masses back, incubate those, and then put them into wetlands. And we've now had recruitment for 3 years, and so we're monitoring how we're doing on that and whether it's going to stick. We want to eventually return sharp-tailed grouse to the reservation and elsewhere in western Montana. We have some habitat problems we still have to work on, and so we're not ready for that, but it's a species very important culturally. Some of the dances are patterned after males on the lek, and so it's a species of a lot of interest for the culture committee. We've been doing an elk migration study on habitat use. It's one that we've wanted to do for about 30 years, and we're finally able to pull the funding together, basically to pretty much sample elk populations all around the edge of the reservation and up through the Salish Mountains. A lot of our elk are pretty sedentary. They don't move a great deal. But these 3 or 4, and especially up in this area in the reservation, these are cows that move quite a ways north. This one ended up clear up by Trigo, halfway between Kalispell and Eureka, each summer, and actually calved up there, and a couple of the others had shorter movements. So it's really given us a little more insight into what these elk do. Are they migratory or not? We did a project with loons a few years ago, implanted transmitters basically that were GPS loaded, and had one bird end up down at Walker Lake in Nevada, another one stopped a few places, ended up almost to Cabo San Lucas, and then another one on the other side of the Sea of Cortez, and another one that ended up down here. I think there was only one of those that actually headed back north again to Saskatchewan to nest, and then there another one that went by, but the transmitter died on it, the battery. So talked about bats a little bit earlier. We did quite an extensive inventory about 4 years ago. Turned up 7 species that weren't known to be in western Montana in our part. One of the things that you worry about with bats is disturbance. And at the same time, we're able to link that concern with concern for safety on some old mine exploration shafts and do some gating to keep people safe, but still be able to have bats be able to come and go. And so a little bat habitat management there. We got into a pickle a few years ago, almost 20 years ago, with Montana Department of Transportation. They came to rebuild Highway 93. We had a lot of concerns. We went through about 10 years of arguing, discussing, negotiating, and came up with an agreement in 2000 between MDOT, Federal Highways, and the tribes, basically to look at Highway 93 to make it safer, make it better, but also to look at the other things that are out there, the non-biotic things and the biotic things, and try to figure out how to make the highway maybe lay a little easier on the land and work a little better with some of the environmental issues that are out there. And in the process, we ended up with quite a number of wildlife crossings, which are pretty much, I travel quite a bit in the West whenever I can, and new designs come up all the time. Almost every state you go to has got some of these, and they're working real well. We patterned a lot of what we did off of what had been done in Banff National Park, both with bridges and culverts, and also one, we have one overcrossing. And, you know, looking at what would work best in those landscapes and those particular sites. And, you know, we one thing we wanted to do is, well, how well do they work? Are they working? Do we need to do something different? So these next couple slides are just photographs that we take with motion-sensitive cameras, a lot of deer, few elk, a lot of black bears. This is a pretty good-sized male grizzly bear, plus other things. A couple young mountain lion teenagers, coyotes, river otters, which I would never have expected. And horned owls come through on a regular basis. They like to perch on the camera sets. They also like to defecate on the camera sets, which doesn't do good for the next pictures that come along. But this is kind of a handle on what we had. All told, there are around 93,000 crossings through there. Of course, we picked up a few local residents, domestic cats and dogs, but by and large, aim pretty heavily on deer because those are the things that are causing a lot of car accidents and personal injury, property injury, and sometimes mortality. And so we want to continue to work on that because, you know, our family, we live there. Our families drive those roads, our kids do, and our neighbors and friends. And so, you know, we think we've had some good success. We've also identified some problems. We need to go back and do a bit more fencing in some areas and you know, refine down on some of the designs we've got. Tom talked a little bit about the river honoring. This is just some photos from that. I got a great setting on the lower Flathead River. And each of these teepees is a station for learning for the kids. This is our wildlife station, and we have activities for them, and we do other things or hike up into the mountains. A lot of classroom work. I have two young ladies who have little kids of their own, and for me, having little kids of my own been 30 years ago, and so I don't speak kid as well as they do, and they're very effective in doing that and working with the kids, and the kids really enjoy it. We have active management partnerships with a whole gamut of agencies and organizations. I didn't put a long list of the NGOs, but there are, you know, some others that aren't listed there, because a lot of things we do, you know, I mean, we operate daily on the realization that wildlife doesn't stay in a box. It doesn't, you know, just because there's a reservation boundary or a state boundary or county boundary, whatever. That's not a pin. And so if we are going to successfully manage species over large landscapes, we've got to be working together and putting our heads together and brainstorming. So with that, that's all I have for my piece. And I can't do things without poking some swans in there somewhere. So anyway, if there are questions, both Tom and I can take a shot at addressing those. Oops, sorry.